Hello and welcome back to beautiful Celosphere. We're here in Munich, beautiful Bavaria. I'll try to get that right today. I'm excited because we get to follow up on an interview we did last year to kind of really into some stuff that's, I think, really important work that's being done, and that really always is talks to what Celonis is about from a cultural perspective as well. Right now, I'm excited to welcome back Dr. Monica Chiarini, almost Tremblay, who is the Hayes T. Watkins Professor of Business at William & Mary. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And Dr. Erin M. Espinosa, who's the Director of Research at Evident Change. Thank you for your first time on board.
Hey, thank you. Thank you for getting the M in there.
I did. I saw it there, so I thought it was important to put the M in there. You know, we like to be very, very formal here. Now for the informal part
All
of it.
Right.
I think, again, you know, we're kind of looking back to last year and everything that's been going on. You two have really joined forces to bring, you know, a use case for applying process intelligence to really improve outcomes for youth, and from a mental health perspective in particular. Why don't you kind of help us understand where we are on the project status and how things have been going?
So it's interesting, at the last year when we last spoke, we were just getting started. We had ingested the data, we were starting to look for patterns, but we didn't quite know what to do with it. And so what we've done a lot of this year is to just get in front of people, present it in front of academic audiences, present it in front of judges, present it in front of stakeholders to see what the possibilities are with this type of approach and what other context might even work with this approach, let's say from a healthcare perspective. But I'd like Erin to add, because she's actually on the ground.
Yeah,
you're doing the real work.
I have a lot of fun. I will say this, I think our partnership has been made in the purpose of making things better for children and families across the world. And what process mining has brought to the game is the ability to tell systems in a different way how their inefficiencies are actually having negative outcomes. And if we hadn't had this opportunity, I never even would have thought to use process mining. I would have been stuck with the traditional binary logistic regression and standard research procedures that practitioners don't understand. And I think one of the things that's been real powerful the last year is being able to take an actual visual of how kids flow through these systems and show judges and probation officers and clinicians that, you know, there is an impact when you make a decision that goes in the wrong direction.
Yeah, and I loved this when we were talking about it last year, because it's so important. Because I think, again, you want people to get better. You want the system to work for them, not against them, when they go into it and have positive outcomes. Monica, you were talking last year about influencing, really policy. And so how has this really come about in the past year? Has there been any progress on the policy side of things, or where do things stand?
So we are still sort of learning how to present this information. So you can imagine our data set has 700,000 mm-hmm. kids, 450,000 of them that intersect with mental health. So juvenile justice data, mental health data, 450,000 of them have data in both data sets, and we're trying to figure out, you know, how to interpret these patterns, because you can imagine not one kid follows the same process, right? So what are the key performance indicators in this case? What do we measure? How do we communicate that? And the only way for us to gather that information is to get in front of people and say, this is what we're finding.
Yeah, I mean, to me, that ties back to what you were saying about some of the analytics and what we would call traditional AI, right? The regression analysis and other things, and using that. But when you're looking at the process intelligence, how does it really, I guess you could say, in your experience, Erin, bridge the gap between, you know, the process intelligence and like real life and what's really happening?
Well, what I can tell you is, in my experience, being a former probation officer, working with these children, running a state juvenile justice system, now being responsible for a large research firm, what I can tell you is that until you can actually sit down with folks and help them know that you truly understand how their system operates and how they operate in it, And then how the children, such as Sue and Sam and others, experience that system, they're not ready to accept that there's anything to change. And what the power of process mining has allowed us to do is almost in a real-time way show them that in a much better fashion than the big marker and crayon, which is the way I used to do it, is just drawing it out and hoping people liked my doodles. But it's pretty powerful stuff when you're actually able to show in an aggregate literally kids spiraling in and out of detention and trying to get treatment and not getting the appropriate treatment and going and off
waiting
into
forever
prison
to get treatment.
Hundreds of days even. And what's even more fascinating is it started conversations in places like district attorney's offices and judges and courts and probation systems around inefficiencies and how inefficiencies can lead to bad outcomes, especially when we allow those inefficiencies to continue to match to inappropriate care for a very long time and don't have the ability to pivot really quickly.
I would say probably one of the key things is sometimes some of the people that are real experienced in the systems, like we presented this to a judge and she said, "We know this, we've known this." I'm like, "Yeah, but did you have evidence and what have you done about it?" Mm-hmm. And this provides us the ability to give them evidence. This is real kids that we're showing you, and this is their data.
You know, last year we started our talk out talking about Chris. And I have a name for almost every scenario I can think of the families I've partnered with. This takes Chris times 400,000 and helps to show the whole community, whole organization, states, counties, territories even, how that compiles into negative outcomes. And so it takes Chris not out of the equation, but gives his voice a much larger one.
Right. And you can start to see the patterns and things like that. What's been surprising that's popped out of the data that, you know, again, was, because I look at it and we've talked to a lot of people, and a lot of times, have you been able to influence, hey, changing the process? Hey, we know if it goes down this path, it's going to be one of those do loops where you're coming back over and over again.
Well, one day I was playing with I was getting ready to give a presentation at IEA, University of Madrid. So I was playing with a dashboard because I knew that there was going to be folks from public health and from the juvenile justice system in Spain there. And one of the things I found is that kids that are given lots of chances but with no repercussions actually just get stuck. Mm-hmm. Right? If they're just constantly getting put on probation, but there's no intervention. And when I presented this, they said, "We see this in Spain as well." And for you, maybe it wasn't like a wow. Because I always think of like, no, we should not be punitive.
Right.
Actually, I saw it from a different perspective. I see it as a true test of what I call, I cannot deny the null hypothesis, right? Like, the fact is that in this particular data set, the kids were limited to the type of treatment that was approved in the Medicaid state plan. And so you can only do so much of the same thing over and over again, and it doesn't work anymore. And so those children that Monica is describing that we called a detention spiral, what you could see is that they were coming in for low-level offenses, but going right back to public mental health and getting the exact same treatment over and over and over again. We were modifying the approach, and then you would see them skyrocket straight into a prison
system. I love
the
example that you give, Erin, sometimes. It's like you show up at the emergency room, and you're like, I'm having a heart attack, and they're like, here's an aspirin.
Yeah.
Right.
That's
right.
Literally it. And to be able to see that with hundreds of thousands of children has a much bigger impact than me just saying, hey, there was this kid once that you worked with. It carries a lot more weight.
And I would expect, because, I mean, companies have this problem in spades, but governments in general, and just knowing some friends who are in government, like the silo of the data and getting access to the data. I know you had this data set and you were getting it all loaded up last year and all of that, but do you see that these agencies, because it goes cross agency, right? And has that changed, or have you been able to change the mind of people that, hey, maybe we need to, you keep your data as the system of record, but we need to unsilo the outcome of the data?
It's a social technical problem, right? Yeah. Because data sharing is not an issue. It's the people that don't want to share, and sometimes for legitimate reasons, yeah. Right? They're concerned about the use of that data, but it can be very powerful, as we have demonstrated just with this small, right, just two agencies. Imagine if we could get education in there too, right?
Or child welfare. I think part of the fear, though, is that when you're dealing with public systems and public systems data becomes public,
yeah.
then it can and make workers fearful that that data will then be weaponized against their jobs and not truly coming back to say we want to do our jobs better and that we want to keep families and children healthy. And you see that a lot. So I think part of it is also understanding that data in a way that isn't making people scared to want to talk about it. And then being able to have some actionable steps to do something with it.
Yeah, I mean, to me, that's got to be just beyond the regulations and everything else and all the stuff that's coming down the pike from an AI perspective and things of that nature, it would seem that this is a place where there hasn't been a lot of this process analysis gone on. I mean, the process re-engineering's been around for decades everywhere else, but are you seeing that people are becoming more receptive of it because you can show them the actual picture of it? Like a picture, you know, is worth a thousand words in a lot of places.
That's actually how this started, right? Like, when I work with large governmental systems, juvenile justice and mental health primarily, what I learned is if I didn't actually draw out how they experienced the work, like literally through a color-coded map, they didn't believe me when I was telling them what their data was saying. So when Monica brought up the idea of using process mining as an opportunity with administrative data, it fit the mold perfectly. What did I miss there?
No, your diagram was beautiful. She actually, like, the colors would merge and blue and yellow would become green.
Yep.
And I mean, it was gorgeous, but I'm like,
she's an artist.
Yeah.
Process artist.
My staff are the artist. I just had the idea.
But I was like, there's literally software that does this, Erin. Let's put it in the software. And we actually have published on this. We just learned that we published an Informs Journal on Computing. But using machine learning techniques, it takes that long to get publications out. But I'm like, this is so much better than a static machine learning algorithm because it's got timestamps, and this is the perfect tool.
Right, and you understand, you can track, because it has that time boundness to it. Yeah.
Well, not only the time, like the you know, what we call the path analysis and how you know how many kids are going through. And what I want to add to that is that you have organizations nationally that are pushing for what they call sharing of data, sharing of case management software right now, but people don't know what to do with that data.
Yeah.
But with what we're working on here, we're actually able to show at what intercept in the system a decision could be made differently, or a intervention could be held differently.
Right.
And then that path could change.
Right.
That has a lot of power when you get it in front of the right people. At least we're hopeful, because that's what we're doing this next year.
And we hope that this can be a pilot to then go bigger, ask for more data sets, merge more information like child welfare, because I'm sure that there's a intersection with foster care for sure.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, talking about the next generation and where this goes, I mean, obviously at William & Mary, and you're training the next set of analysts that are looking into this stuff. Is this tying back into that and helping them see the potential?
So I've actually brought quite a few graduate students, because this project is so large that you can take many angles. So we are doing an economic analysis, and in that analysis we've involved an undergraduate student. We've got several graduate students working on sort of looking at the path analysis and deciding what a key performance indicator is. So I've got a pretty large group of graduate students now looking at it, and I like the aspect, William & Mary is a liberal arts institution, of data science for good.
I love the pathway of students who are going through the business schools actually getting to see how they're skills can be applied to change social justice systems. And remember, these are systems that our tax dollars go into anyway. So I feel like we have to start challenging them like we challenge Amazon and others. Like, do a better job delivering what you're set out to do. And we can't do that if we don't empower the youth coming up to have that voice. Is that fair to say?
I would say, yeah, they're not even aware of these problems, right? Mm-hmm. They are young, and it's so nice, it's so good to expose them to it and to empower them to try to make a difference.
Yeah, I mean, help them, I know, because I have both my kids are at university now, so I like understand how they think, fortunately or unfortunately. And to your point, I always tell them, I'm like, go out and see beyond this and, you know, try stuff outside your area, so that you become aware of more that's going on, because that's so important. So final question, you know, hopefully we'll be here again next year and we can do another update. We'll start with you, Erin. What do you hope to say next year at Celosphere 2026 that you can't say today?
I would love for us to actually have a place where we can demonstrate this actively occurring in a system that's trying to reform itself.
I would agree with Erin. I would love to have not a pilot anymore, but an actual project.
Yeah, I don't like to call things pilots, because pilots stay around forever. Yeah. Demonstration. We're going to demonstrate it can work.
No, I don't want it to be. I want it to be an actual project with a municipality.
It's installed.
So yeah. To your point, that's why even at Amazon they use the word preview, because it goes from preview into GA.
All right, we want to see it preview.
Want to go from preview to GA, and that'll be great. So I look forward to being able to talk about this. Thank you for coming on board and giving us an update. It's really important stuff, and I thank you for doing it.
Thank you for having us. We really appreciate it.
And thank you for watching this episode from Celosphere, live here in Munich 2025. We'll be back with more on theCUBE, the leader in analysis and news. Stay tuned.